Welcome to the Power Talk Show with me, Dominic George. It's another Wednesday. Today we're speaking about how your emotional health matters. And today with me, I've got Arthur Moriuki, who is a consulting psychologist with the Brain Initiative. And he'll be speaking to us about this important conversation. So, you know, being emotional and psychological health is very, very important. I think some of us tend to ignore how important this is. But I know that we have been reading on our social media pages, people committing suicide, and sometimes there are people who are unable to deliver because of psychological and emotional issues at work. These things do affect us in our relationships, in our work, in our schools, and it's important to deal with them early. So you need to ask yourself, what makes you have more negative emotions than positive ones? And what can you do to make that difference? So be part of this conversation. Why your emotional health is important, and this conversation is being led by none other than Arthur Moriuki, who is a consulting psychologist and works with the Brain Initiative. So go to our social media pages, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Y254 and talk to us. Or you can even go to my own Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at I am Kamau Mwangi and talk to me. So now I'm going to give it to At Africa Band are here with us, and they are going to be entertaining us during this show. So At Africa, let's go.
So for those who are watching us at home, welcome. We are talking of this great person who can make your emotional health just go up. Are we together? So listen to this. Welcome to the Power Talk Show.
Nilikuwa natafuta rafiki atakaye kuwa wa kudumu. Nilikuwa nimekosa futi tena upendo wako unanipa nguvu baba nikiwa nawe Yesu nitaogopa nani nitaogopa nini najua hutaniacha pawe na shida pasiwe wewe ni mwaminifu Hutaniacha pawe na shida pasiwe wewe ni mwaminifu milele
so mimi najua tena najua
hutaniacha pawe na shida pasiwe wewe ni mwaminifu milele
nasema mimi najua
hutaniacha pawe na shida pasiwe wewe ni mwaminifu Never failing. All things are working for my good. He's intentional. Never failing.
When my emotions are down,
all things are working for my good.
When my emotions are down,
he's intentional. Never failing.
At Africa Band. It's good to have you back, by the way. Masanga, how are you doing? How is the new month treating you?
The new month is treating us with a mood of love.
With a mood of love.
It is the love.
You know, it's the month of love, eh?
Yes.
Awesome, awesome. Yes. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the show. As I told you, today we're talking about why your emotional health matters. And the one who's leading us through this conversation is Arthur Moriuki. Arthur Moriuki is a consulting psychologist who works for the Brain Initiative. And he will be helping us with this conversation. As I mentioned to you, go to our Facebook Instagram and Twitter pages, Y254, or check out my own page, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook, at I Am Kama Mwangi, and be part of this conversation. There is a post on there, and you can comment and ask your question or give a suggestion or an opinion. So, Mr. Arthur Muriuki, welcome to the show.
Yeah, thank you very much.
You were here some time ago.
Yes.
And it's good to have you back. So, emotional well-being or emotional health. Possibly we can start with what is that?
Okay. So when you talk about emotional health, it's a new, very fascinating area of research that we are now seeing a lot of emphasis going into, because I think all of us are familiar with the term, the IQ,
yes,
the intelligence quotient.
Yeah.
And we initially used to think that as long as you have a very high IQ, then you can adapt to any environment. Because it's about intelligence. But we've come to see that even people who are highly intelligent, they face some challenges in adapting to some environment. So the question was asked, what is it that they could be
lacking
or struggling with? So as I think around 2002 is when now there are two researchers who came up with the term emotional quotient. Now EQ, or referred to as EQ. Now emotional intelligence is the ability, as defined, is the ability to feel, read and respond to,
or feel, read and respond to.
So the ability to read someone's emotions, what it is that they are feeling, and to understand it, and also to know what is expected, the expected normal response to that kind of an emotion.
Yeah.
So this is both inward to yourself and also outward to the environment.
To the environment.
Yes.
So it seems to me it's the way you are able to deal with what life throws at you.
Yes.
Without allowing whatever life throws at you to consume you.
Yes. So for example, all over the tribes of the world, or the human race, there are five common emotions that are present in all human beings, and that is anger.
Anger.
All over the world, people are able to feel the emotion of anger. They're also able to feel the emotion of fear. They're also able to feel the emotion of sadness. They're also able to feel the emotion of hurt. And lastly, they're also able to feel the emotion of joy. Okay? So your ability to, one, read that emotion on another person, or to even become aware that this is how I'm feeling, and also to read it on another person, you've done well on the scale of emotional intelligence.
You're doing very well.
Yes.
In that.
So if you can interpret, for example, when I'm looking at you, if I can tell, are you disgusted by what I'm saying? So now I know you're lying to me. are you disgusted what I'm saying by what I'm saying? Are you interested in what I'm saying? Do am I boring you? Is what I'm saying making sense? So my ability to read that will also now inform how I respond. Do I shut up? Do I continue speaking? Do I give examples? Are you squinting your eyes and trying to figure out what is this guy talking about? So do I need to be more elaborative? So that helps us have a good kind of interaction. And as we talk further on these, we'll also look at how does emotional intelligence, or lack of it, affect how people interact, either with romantic relationships, or with family, or at work, or in school, or within their environment.
Yeah, but actually I'm going to use an example of a romantic relationship. So let's say someone has been, there's been a breakup of a relationship, and I'm trying to point out to the fact that sometimes there are events that can happen in your life that leave you with highly toxic, negative emotions, right? So what is the balance that I feel bad that this happened, but at the same time, I don't want to let this breakup or this death of a person consume me. So what is the proper response to this?
Okay, so what I'd like to point out in the beginning, that the ability to feel is very critical. It's what makes us human. That, for example, if I lose a loved one, then I'm able to feel that loss. And how I feel it could be either maybe I'm in denial, or I am very angry about it, that this person has died and has left me in a lot of debt, or that I was so connected to this person and now all that investment is lost, or I really loved this person and then they are gone. I'll never see them again. Who is going to fill that void? I'm so lonely. So the ability to understand that this is how I'm feeling,
yeah.
And then to know that, for example, if this is if this is how I'm feeling, am I aware of how I'm interacting with my environment? For example, when I come here to speak to you and I've lost a loved one, am I aware of how I'm interacting with you? Am I moody? Am I irritable? Am I on edge? Am I very aggressive? Am I rude? Am I, because if I'm struggling with that emotion, I don't want to let it out safely, then I'm going to lay it out on you in a negative way. True. So a healthy balance is if you're able to identify at every single moment what it is that you're feeling, are you also able to see how it's informing your thought processes and consequently your behavior?
True.
So are you reacting emotionally to what's going on, or are you
responding?
Yes, are you responding appropriately to what is required in that environment? So that would be a healthy balance, to be able to identify and then consciously choose, how do I want to respond here?
So I how do I process, first of all, right, that I am feeling lonely? So what do I do with that emotion? Do I simply let it, like, do I simply go through it, or how do I deal with it? Because there are people who commit suicide, let's say when one of their loved one dies, or when they are left, maybe they were in a relationship, they had invested everything in it. So some go into the negative response. They like, I'm not gonna date again, or they break apart.
So what we'd like to even begin by pointing out is that when you lose a loved one, it is normal. It is normal to feel sad. It is normal to feel, to go into grief. It is normal to mourn. It is normal to feel heaviness, a lot of sadness. That's very normal. So what we encourage people to do is that do not avoid feeling the sadness. Do not avoid feeling sometimes even guilt that this person died. Maybe I should have been the one who died. Maybe it was a road accident. They died. I survived. It should have been me. To acknowledge those emotions, because the reason why sometimes we feel so deeply when we lose a close loved one is because of the nature of the relationship we had. Maybe they were so close to us, or maybe we had a very constrained relationship and I didn't have enough time to resolve it before the person passed away. So we encourage you, do not avoid that emotion. Now the risk with avoiding it is that you will try block it or numb it using other ways, other what we call maladaptive tendencies. For example, you will say, if I can, as long as I drink a lot, or I smoke too much, or I go on a shopping spree, or I distract myself long enough, I won't have to feel this way.
Sure.
But see, the human body is not created to forget painful events. It records if you do not want to let them out, and then it brings them up when you least want them to come up. So one of the things we encourage, keep your friends close. Get very good support around you, and people who are encouraging with you and sitting with you and supporting you.
So now, let me interrupt there. You know, you have said that when you lose someone, have a good supportive system.
Yes.
But there are people who have emotions of, am I being a burden to them? So they don't allow themselves to be helped because somehow they feel like, let me just deal with my own issues.
Yeah.
Then, like, carrying, even though other people want to help them, you know, they're like, no.
Yes, it's a common phenomena that we observe. And sadly, this is more common amongst men than it is on women. Because, for example, if it's a husband who's lost a wife and the other children who've been left, the man has been taught as a young boy, do not show emotion, do not show the negative emotions. That's a feminine quality. So suck it up, be like a man, be a man. So when now he's faced with all this grief, there's no appropriate, there are no society approved ways of how they accept a man to express emotion. So what this man tends to do is, because they don't want to show this sign of weakness, that I'm crying, I miss my wife, I'm mourning her, why did she die, and I don't want people to see me in that quote-unquote weak state, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to drink it out. Okay, or I'm going to work myself off. I'm going to overwork myself, and then enjoy the title of workaholic, because then I'm achieving a lot.
Yeah.
So what we encourage, especially the ones who feel that burden, that if I mourn, who's going to take care of the rest of the activities that need to be? And also the statement that you mentioned, that I feel like I'm a burden to people. Now that blocks your expression of that emotion. So you turn it inwardly. Now, sadly, when you turn an emotion inwardly, especially if it's a negative emotion, mm-hmm. the body does not know how to safely retain it. So it comes out with headaches and lower back pains and joint pains and stomach ulcers and indigestion and very serious medical conditions. Somatic, and then you go to hospital and the doctor says we can't find anything. So until you find a medical practitioner who's asking you, hey, what's going on in your life, you'll keep on going to hospital and not be able to connect those two.
True.
So that's why we encourage people, if you find yourself grieving or experiencing frequently a heavy load of emotions, and you've tried so many things and you're not able to get better or feel better, then seek professional help.
Absolutely.
It is not unmanly to seek help. Mm. It's actually a sign of strength and courage to go find someone and say, hey,
and talk to that person.
Yes.
All right. So now, last two questions that I have here for you. So, what are the key building blocks for emotional health? What are like five things you could say a person needs to consider the following five pointers for them to observe or to have a healthy emotional health?
Okay. So even with reasoning it out, one of the things we encourage people to do is something called self-awareness. How well are you aware of what's going on internally? For example, if I asked you right now as you're listening to me, what emotion are you experiencing? Are you able to identify it? Can you tell me?
I would say calm.
Calm. Mm. So calm, is it close to joy, happiness, low-level joy?
Contentment.
Contentment. Mm. So how often are you aware of that emotion?
Mm.
Okay, so that, for example, if maybe on my way out of this studio I step on your toes, then will you still be able to remain calm?
Mm.
Okay, so self-awareness. What's going on internally within me?
Mm.
And is it being affected by the environment?
Mm.
If there's a chaotic environment over there, maybe you have your supervisor or your boss or your colleague who is constantly on your case. Why are you not doing this? Why are you doing this? How do you respond to this person? Mm. So self-awareness. Mm. Am I allowing the external environment to affect my internal environment?
Okay.
So self-awareness.
Self-awareness.
Now, number two is how conscious are you of how your emotions inform your thought processes.
Mm.
So that, for example, the same example I used, if I step on your toes walking out of the studio, how are you going to interpret that action?
Yeah.
Is it that I am very disrespectful, or I don't think
he hits me? he's a witch.
Yes. So, or are you going to think I think you're totally useless, or I think your shoes are very ugly, or was it an accident?
I'll go with useless.
So based on the meaning that you give that behavior, it may or may not affect how you respond to me. So that, for example, if you think I was very disrespectful and rude, how might you respond to me?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So
you may punch me or push me or shove me, or
it depending on the size of your
So but if you think, oh, maybe it was an accident, he didn't see my foot, then that will inform how you react to me.
Mm.
So because you will not stop me and ask me, hey, why did you step on my toes? Didn't you see my foot?
Mm.
So let
me pause you there.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other side, I can turn it towards myself, right?
Mm-hmm.
Possibly I'm so useless, that's why he's stepping on me, right? So
yes.
I deserve it.
Yes. So now if you do that, it will also inform your behavior. So what you'll tend to do the next time we meet, you may either wear very the metallic shoes that have a metallic front, to protect your toes, or you may avoid me altogether. You may not invite me here again, or you may try to look for something negative about me so that you can fill in with the negativity, or you may choose something else.
Mm.
Now, how you interpret that behavior emotionally will affect even the quality of our relationship.
True.
How will you treat me the next time I come to see you, or we bump into each other somewhere else?
Yeah.
So the ability to relate emotion and thought process is also very, very important.
Okay,
yes.
Okay.
Now, the third one is, after I have read your emotions, after I've checked with myself, how am I responding? The last one is, what do I expect in my response? So that, for example, if you have judged that situation as it was an accident, so you remain calm, But then when I get there, I insult you. I turn around and I insult you.
Yes. Okay.
So that calmness might be perturbed.
Because I assumed goodwill.
Yes.
And now you have confirmed that actually there was no goodwill.
Yes.
So now I have to change my whole point of reference.
Yes.
Okay.
So at that point, again, you have a choice. Do you still want to remain calm?
Yeah.
Or do you want to be affected by my statement?
Mm.
So. If you want to remain calm, some of the thought processes that might be helpful is if you start to consider, maybe I've had a bad day.
Mm.
Maybe there's some things I've not processed.
I'm depressed.
Or I'm depressed or something. And if you say that to yourself, because remember, you may not have time to ask me, why did I do that?
Mm.
That will now inform how you react.
Yeah.
Now, it is very important for people to be able to in the moment, hold back this reaction and consider, am I reacting? Why am I reacting the way I'm reacting? And if we find time, we'll also link these with now mental illness. How does...
Unfortunately.
Yes.
We are running out of time.
Okay. So it's more pervasive than that.
Mm.
So that if you're not able to always hold back, then it could begin to point to an underlying mental illness.
Okay.
So it's always advisable to prevent.
Mm.
To when you still can, to control... try and stop yourself and stop the impulse to react.
Okay.
So as long as you can do that, then you're on a good scale to being emotionally intelligent.
I know we are remaining with 2 points, but right now we're going to take a break and so they can give it back to South Africa. So we're gonna take a break, and then when we come back, we shall conclude with the last two, and then we call it off.
So
Atha Mariuki is continuing with us with the conversation on emotional health, emotional well-being, and how important it is. So please don't go away. I'm going to give it back to South Africa for a break before we resume. South Africa, let's go.
They see in me, they see beauty. I see everything wrong. I wanna know what they see in me. Believe in me again, like I believe. Of losing my focus, was too busy chasing what they wanted me to be. Living through their eyes, drained by the spotlight, wasting away for the world's plans for me. Believe in me like I believed in me again. Oh, like I believed in me back then. Get back to the place where I left long ago, when no one could tell me what's again.
Africa band. Great piece. Absolutely amazing piece. Welcome back. So we are still talking about emotional health. And as we conclude, I'd like to just mention we have been talking about Jordan Peterson's laws, rules to life. And today, just before I go back to Mr. Arthur Morioki to conclude for us, the fourth law says compare yourself to you. One of the biggest, I'm sure, cause of unhappiness, and maybe could be the fourth one that you've been speaking about, what are the emotional building blocks? What are the building blocks that can help you live a healthy life? Is comparison with yourself. So there is a very good point here that where you are, you cannot compare yourself with any other person because you don't know why they are where they are. And the moment you start comparing yourself with others, you deny yourself the chance of becoming the best you that you can be. And there are so many people who lead very depressed and very unhappy lives because every time they go to a certain distance, they realize that someone else is ahead of them. And let me tell you something, as Jordan Peterson says, however good you are at a certain field, you'll always find someone who is better than you who might make you feel utterly useless at how good you are, and you forget how good you are. So when it comes to talents or even relationships or family, that sometimes you might find yourself that there's someone always better than you. So Jordan Peterson says it's better to compare yourself and say, between yesterday and today, am I better than I was? Not that am I better than anyone else? Am I richer than anyone else? Am I more handsome? Or am I getting compared to the others? How am I comparing? That can suck your energy, and I believe that could be the fourth building block to making us even more happier and becoming even more fulfilled persons. But I want to take it back to Arthur Morioki, who is from the Brain Initiative, to continue with this conversation on emotional health. So welcome back.
The other thought that I'd like people to consider is something we call self-control. Now, this is so important, especially when you're having human-human interaction. So that, for example, if I'm your boss and I do something that, or you do something to me that I find very disrespectful, and I decide on the spot you're fired, okay? And then without any consideration to the labor laws and all of that. And then you decide, okay, I'm going to go home. Then you get a lawyer and come sue me. So, and you win the case. So my company is going to hemorrhage a lot of money. And when you trace back the footsteps, it's because I interpreted a statement or a behavior that I observed in you and determined you're either insubordinating or you're very rude or etc. etc. Yeah. And now we cannot pay bills because now we have to settle bills with you. And the labor courts say, I cannot fire you. You have to come back to my office. So then I have to see you and look at that face, that judgmental face, and then say, keep thinking my thoughts. So you think you won't, so you think I can't fire you again, or you thought you could let me go like that. Now I can decide I'm not going to work because I have money anyway. I've gotten money off the company. So the inability to have self-control has far-reaching consequences. Now, we've been seeing on media an increasing number of homicides. So a man comes home, or a wife comes home, or children come home, and they decide what they find in the home is not pleasing enough to them, and they react on the spot. And that leads to serious bodily harm and death. So when you trace back and you interview these people, you ask them, what happened? And they are so remorseful. They seriously cannot understand how did that lead to that, to that, to that. And now they have to do time in prison. So self-control is a skill. It is not a privilege or an aspect that is for a certain group of people and not for others. So the ability to feel an emotion so intensely and to acknowledge that this is how you're feeling and to be able to tell yourself, calm down. Let it pass, and then to respond with more logic saves you a lot more heart in the long run. So self-control
is a very key component.
So the last one, and there are many, so we mentioned briefly on the last one, is something we call perseverance. So if, for example, and I'll keep using this example, at work, we may have colleagues who maybe we don't think too highly of them, and maybe these colleagues are our superiors, or they're our juniors who maybe report to us, and they can sabotage us if they feel like, because we are going to look bad. So how well are you able to live in this environment where you are not able to change the dynamics in your favor? Will you always be moody? Will you always be the most gloomy person in the office? Will you always be the person who is the worst team player because there's someone in the team who you don't see eye to eye? So the ability to acknowledge that this is how I feel in the presence of this person, and what do I interpret? How do I interpret this person's behavior? And because I'm going to be in this person's, in the same team with this person, how then can I modify my reaction towards this person so that it does not affect my career?
Yeah, yeah.
So the ability, especially when you cannot move around the dynamics in your favor, to put differently, tolerance, to be able to tolerate an emotion that is not very endearing to you.
So basically, if you cannot control a situation or a person and the way they behave towards you, the best thing is to look at your own environment, emotional preparedness or reaction. So that when you meet this person, you're like, okay, I'm going to meet a difficult person, so how can I preempt an ugly situation or a depressive situation on my side?
And then calm yourself down well enough to be able to respond calmly and to be able to think clearly. Because we normally say that if your emotional intelligence is not well developed, then you will almost always find it difficult to adapt to any new environment. So emotional intelligence is key to adapting to any milestone, like getting married, like getting a new job, like
getting a promotion.
So it helps even for managers when they are promoting people to supervisory positions to have this person assessed. How well emotionally developed are they? So they may have very good managerial skills, technical skills, but then how do they
interact
with other people, and will they cause a lot of people to leave the company, or will cause a lot of people to join the company and work to give their best.
Thank you so much. I appreciate so much, Mr. Doctor. I'm going to call you doctor. Is it doctor okay?
It's Mr. So for now.
For now. Okay. Yes. Mr. Arthur Muriuki from the Brain Initiative. Thank you so much for making time to come to the Power Talk Show and sharing with us about emotional health. I really appreciate you coming. And I would love to continue with this conversation. But because of time, let's close it up at this. And thank you once again.
Okay.
So that has been Arthur Muriuki. So Arthur Muriuki is from the Brain Initiative, like I've mentioned to you. And I want to thank you for being part of this show, for watching our show. And thank you so much. May God bless you. Continue this conversation on Y254 Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. And I'm going to give it back to at Africa Band to close the show for us. God bless you and have a good night. Go mad. Make a difference. Good night.
Hizi vitu ndogo ndogo zisifanye nikununie baba. Hizi vitu ndogo ndogo zisifanye nisikuimbie baba. Hizi vitu ndogo ndogo zisifanye nikununie baba.
Hizi vitu ndogo ndogo ndogo.
Hizi vitu ndogo ndogo
ndogo.
Hizi vitu ndogo ndogo
ndogo.
Hizi vitu ndogo ndogo
ndogo.
Ndogo,
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 ndogo.
Sukari imepanda na unga, hizo vitu ndogo. Nimekonda na yule ameunga, hizo vitu ndogo. Unashinda ukilia kusota, hizo vitu ndogo. Kaburini alishinda hata kifo, hizo vitu ndogo. Bila Yesu nitikide. Mimi bahati de. Nakwambia shida zako ni ndogo de. Anakuchekide everyday. Ukikomplain to your holiday. Hizo vitu ndogo de. Mbele yake ndogo ndogo kama ode de.
Hizo vitu ndogo ndogo
ndogo.
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 tabu tena shida zanizunguka maisha ya bala watu washanga minangoja pumzi ya uhai kutoka kwako
minangoja
pumzi ya uhai kutoka kwako I am weary tired of this body won't you come and give me life Won't you come and give me life?
Breathe again, give me life. Breathe again, give me life. Breathe again, give me life. Breathe, breathe. Breathe again, give me life.
Of your love is all I need.
Is all I need.
You need to let me know. Can this dry bone sleep? Cause I've been waiting for a while, and it is time.
Waiting
for a while, and it is time.
I am worried,
tired of this body. Won't you come and give me life?
Breathe again, give me life. Breathe again, give me life. Breathe again, give me life. Breathe, breathe. Breathe again, give me life. Breathe again.
Again.